There is an old story told about Rabbi Yisrael Salinger. He was a great leader of the Jewish community in Lithuania in the 1800s. He was the head of a movement of educational and ethical reforms that spread across Lithuania, Germany, and Russia in those days. Rabbi Salinger once noticed that a fancy restaurant was charging a huge price for a cup of coffee. He approached the owner and asked why the coffee was so expensive. After all, some hot water, a few coffee beans, and a spoonful of sugar could not amount to more than a few cents. The owner replied, "It is correct that for a few cents you could have coffee in your own home. But here, in the restaurant, we provide exquisite decor, soft music in the background, professional waiters, and the finest china on which to serve your cup of coffee." And Rabbi Salinger's face lit up. "Oh, thank you very much. Now I understand the meaning of the blessing we pray before drinking water. All was created by his word. You see, until now when I recited this blessing, I had only in mind that I was thanking the Creator for the water he created. Now, I understand the blessing much better. All includes not merely the water, but the fresh air we breathe while drinking the water, the beautiful world around us, the music of the birds that entertain us and exalt our spirits, each with its different voice, the charming flowers with their splendid colors and marvelous hues, the fresh breeze. For all of this, we have to thank God when drinking our water." It sounds so simple, so elegant, offering praise to God for the countless gifts that fill each moment. The fact of our presence here, in this place today, is filled with thousands of miracles. Miracles of divine sustenance and miracles of human ingenuity. Most of us arrived here this morning in automobiles. Automobiles forged from materials gathered from across the face of the entire earth. These vehicles brought us here not by our own strength or the strength of animals, but by the power of millions of tiny explosions fueled by chemicals that began their existence tens of millions of years ago. And that's just how we got here today. These miracles brought us to this edifice, an edifice made of clay and rock and iron and wood, shaped by the hands of craftsmen generations before us. They entrusted it to us for our spiritual well-being. What aspect of our lives is not graced by countless gifts from others and gifts from God? If our minds were awake to even a portion of these, words of gratitude and thanksgiving would flow from our lips every single moment. But that's not what we do, is it? As we gather in a few days to celebrate the holiday of Thanksgiving, it is not too hard to believe that some of us might hear words that are the very opposite of thanksgiving: complaining. Gratitude is awareness of the presence of what we have, and complaining is awareness of what we do not have. What we lack in possessions, what we lack in opportunity, what we lack in control of others, what we lack in power. Do you imagine that you might hear a word or two of complaint in the next days? Someone might complain that the kids around the table will not put away their phones or devices. But how much better to give thanks for the abundance of resources and the lack of need that make owning such expensive devices possible. The raw information available to those little fingers is more than all of the libraries of the world could ever contain. Someone might complain that others will not bow their heads in prayer in the way that they want them to. How much better to give thanks for the freedom of conscience and character to honor each day as one sees fit. Our Baptist visionaries, like Roger Williams, paid dearly for the freedom of religion and the freedom from religion. Williams believed that forced worship stinks in God's nostrils. Someone might complain that the traditions of yesteryear are not kept as they once were. But how much better to give thanks for the opportunity to see the present generation live into the fullness of their values, and getting to see it while there is still breath in our bodies. The Apostle Paul reminds us, "Do all things without murmuring or arguing, so that you may be blameless and innocent children of God, without blemish in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, in which you shine like stars in the world." What does complaining accomplish? Changing hearts and minds? Convincing others that you are right or better? No, not at all. The stars of our lives should cast light on the countless gifts that fill our world, not cast the shadows of our expectations and our disappointments. Complaining does not advance the mission of God in the world. It dims the light of God's people. In the early 20th century, the author Khalil Gibran wrote a wonderful book called The Prophet. In it, a group of people gather around an old man named Al-Mustafa on the evening before he was to set out on a journey home. Each person gathered around the table asked him questions about different parts of life, and he shared his wisdom with them. I'd like to share with you one of the questions asked in this book. Khalil Gibran writes, "Then an old man, a keeper of an inn, said to Al-Mustafa, 'Speak to us of eating and drinking.' And Al-Mustafa said, 'Would that you could live on the fragrance of the air, of the fragrance of the earth, and like an air plant, be sustained by light. But since you must kill to eat, and rob the young of its mother's milk to quench your thirst, then let it be an act of worship. And let your board stand an altar on which the pure and innocent of forest and plain are sacrificed for that which is pure and still more innocent in man. When you kill a beast, say to him in your heart, by the same power that slays you, I too am slain, and I too shall be consumed. For the law that delivered you into my hand shall deliver me into a mightier hand. Your blood and my blood is naught but the sap that feeds the tree of heaven. And when you crush an apple in your teeth, say to it in your heart, your seeds shall live in my body. And the buds of your tomorrow shall blossom in my heart, and your fragrance shall be my breath. Together we shall rejoice through all the seasons. And in the autumn, When you gather the grapes of your vineyard for the wine press, say in your heart, I too am a vineyard. And my fruit shall be gathered for the wine press, and like new wine, I shall be kept in eternal vessels. And in winter, when you draw the wine, let there be in your heart a song for each cup. Let there be in the song a remembrance of the autumn days, and for the vineyard, and for the wine press. In these holy days of harvest and celebration, of gathering in and of family, may the songs in our hearts banish every complaint. May they be swallowed in words of thanksgiving. And may the brightness of our lives shine light on God.